back at it, my friends. Back in the most fabulous card club in all the land. And we are going to be in there, through that door. That's where the fun happens, the magic happens, and the bloodbaths happen. We're gonna be playing 5-10, 5-10. As you guys know, things always play bigger in Texas. Today, I expect no different. Let's go.
This will be the biggest 5-10 game you've ever seen in your life. That's because it's not really a 5-10 game, even though those are the only mandatory blinds. 25 straddle will be on immediately. Shortly after that, so will the 50, the 100, the 200, eventually the 400, the 800, and even the $1,600 straddle gets on in this game. It's ridiculous and insane and very easily leads to multiple five-figure pots.
One additional twist to this game, as if these games in Texas need any additional action, but we are playing Fire Truck Friday, or On Fire Friday, or whatever it's called. So basically, if you win a hand, you get the fire truck put in front of you, a little toy fire truck. If you then win another hand, two in a row, every player at the table pays you $50. If you win a third hand in a row, every player then pays you $100. And it keeps going up $50 every time you win subsequent hands. So basically, you want to win multiple hands in a row, and that will lead us into the first hand that I get involved with on the day, in which a player who goes by the name Scuba Steve has the fire truck in front of him. So basically, you want to try and ensure that Scuba Steve does not win the next hand, because then you also have to pay him a bounty as well as whatever you happen to lose in the hand. So hopefully you don't get too carried away here as we see Boots coming in for the limp out of the low jack spot, and we look down at the 9-8 offsuit. Let's get carried away here. I go ahead, bump it up here, raise it up to $100, both trying to iso the limper as well as trying to make sure Scuba is not the winner of this hand. Now, Scuba, right on cue, gets after it with the fire truck in front of him, goes ahead and three bets in this spot, $260 out of the cutoff spot. Action folds back around to me. We're getting a fantastic price now, only $160 more, and trying to defend versus the man with the fire truck. So we are in there with a not exactly premium holding 9-8 offsuit in the three bet pot, but we go heads up to a flop. Jack 9-7, two diamonds gives us a pair plus a gut shot. Could be better, could be worse. Check to the aggressor, who continues with a c-bet of $360. No choice here. Toss in the call. Turns not too bad. 10 of spades, that gives us a straight. There's better straights possible. King, queen, of course. But I think a lot of better hands are going to slow down here with a check back. Pocket aces, pocket kings, maybe even a set or two pair. Might want to take a card off here. I want to prevent that. I want to go for some value here versus those kinds of hands. I lead out now for $375. Scuba thinks about it for a little bit and makes the call. Auto river card now, which is pretty bad. Offsuit queen. We're basically never going to have ace king in this spot. I would always four bet that hand preflop in this scenario. Any king also makes a better straight than the one we have. Check it over to Scuba here.
Yeah, bro.
Really?
Hoping to get to showdown here, and that is what happens. He goes ahead and checks it back, and as it turns out, we are in a chopping scenario. He's got the pocket eights. We get there. Actually got there on the flop, but end up chopping this one. And better news is that the fire truck returns to the station. No bounties on chop pots, and he doesn't even get to retain the fire truck. So a little bit of additional good news there. Hand number 9 of the stream here. We see Skull Mike coming in for the raise up to $75 out of the hijack. Flo makes the call on the button. We're in the big blind looking down at King 9 of hearts. Solver likes to put this King 9 suited into the 3-bet range pretty frequently here. If we get a chance to squeeze, and if I get a chance to play like a solver, you guys know how scientific I approach all things in life, especially poker. So I'm going to put in the 3-bet, bump this thing up to $475, getting after it here. Good news, folds back around to Skull Mike, who thinks about it before letting it go, but Flo, not in the mood to fold. He's going to defend his button, calls the 3-bet, and we go heads up to a flop. No improvement on the Jack 8-4-2 clubs. Don't want to just check give up with King High here, though. Fire out for a C-bet, $325. Flo not ready to release yet. Goes ahead and makes the call. Chances are that he's not that strong, though, when he just calls relatively quickly here on this flop. Very wet and dynamic board. I think if he does have a strong hand, like Ace-Jack or better, two pairs, sets, he's going to find a raise almost always on this kind of a board. Could have some draws himself. So when the 6 of clubs hits the turn and we have basically no hope of making any sort of a hand here, just check it over to him, see what happens. And he decides to check it back here kind of quickly. So I don't think, again, that he has too much. I think he's weighted pretty heavily towards one pair type hands. And the river is pretty interesting. It's the 5 of clubs putting 4 to a straight and 4 to a flush on the board. We've got one of the worst hands that we could possibly ask for here with a king high. So with all those possibilities out there on the river, I think a stab makes a lot of sense here. Not sure if we need to go too big. If he does have a club, I think he's going to be inclined to call a fair amount of the time. If not, he's probably just going to have to give it up. So I fire out for $500, and maybe we could have sized up a little bit more than this, but I think it's not terrible. But as it turns out, Flo has backdoored into a straight. Thinks about it for a little while, but eventually says, if we've got a club, we're good. He's going to pay off with a straight, though. Tosses in the $500. He's got himself the winning hand here, of course.
And he's going to take it down.
Hand number 22 of the stream now, and we've actually been super card dead so far in the early going of this show. This is the third hand that I've highlighted here, and none of them have been very good. This one included, we got the Jack 10 offsuit following a raise from Skull Mike out of the cutoff spot. Up to $200. Lots of straddling going on. I think we got the $50 straddle line in this hand. And we're actually playing the knit game, and we're down to heads up in the knit game between myself and Skull Mike. So when Mike comes in for the raise, of course, we got to get in there with our Jack 10. Scuba Steve follows suit out of the low jack spot, and we go three ways to a flop. 9-5-3, two hearts, couple backdoor draws, but not much to be proud of so far. Check it, Scuba checks, and Skull Mike checks behind, which gives us a free look at the turn card, which is the 10 of hearts. Great looking card here. Upgrade to top pair, plus we got a jack high flush draw. Don't want to give any free cards in this spot. I fire out for about half pot, $300. Scuba not one to fold too easily. He goes ahead and makes the call. And Mike wants to see one more card as well. Not ready to release. A little unclear where we're at. We might have the best hand, or we might not. We might have the best draw, or we might not. River comes in 9, and that shouldn't help anybody too often, as the flop had checked through. Maybe some chance Scuba checked the razor on the 9-high flop, but that man can have anything. I decided to check it, and Scuba checks it as well. Over to Skull Mike. He's going to be the least likely to have a 9 after checking through on the flop. He gives up, waves the white flag. Show down our Jack 10, and that is the best hand. Scuba had himself a pair of 5s with a queen high flush draw. Skull Mike just ace high with a 7 high flush draw. We get to release the knit button. Unfortunate for Skull Mike, he's got to pay out the knit tax. But as for us, we get to drag this pot in. Hand number 25 now, and you can see just how card dead I am by the quality of these holdings that I'm playing. I don't want to just knit it up on a stream, though. I want to get in there, get in the mix, keep this VPIP number up. I raise the 5 deuce suited on the button up to $30. Scuba sees right through it, though. He goes ahead and puts in the 3-bet up to $60 out of the small blind. Dev makes the cold call in the big blind, and we're getting way too good of a price with a 5-deuce suited to do anything other than make the call. So three ways to a flop. That comes down ace, 6-deuce, bottom pair for us. Action checks over to us here on this ace-high board. Not going to fire, just decided to check this one back three ways. Turn a beautiful, lovely deuce of clubs, giving us trips now. Scuba now decides to lead out into the field here for $160, and Dev makes the call out of the big blind. And I think we've got a premium raising candidate here with our trip deuces, clubs available to charge for value, and of course top pairs that decided not to fire on a dry flop. So I go ahead and raise this one up to $475. Back over to the preflop aggressor, Scuba, who decides to let it go, considering he has King 10, nothing working for him there. Over to Dev now, who would be the more likely candidate to actually have either a flush draw or a top pair. And after giving it some thought, he decides to make the call. Off to a river card, ideally looking to dodge clubs, and we do on the 3 of hearts. Got a 5 in our hand, straights seem very unlikely in this spot. Maybe he could have the last deuce sometimes, but we're obviously going for additional value here on the river. Targeting some ace-x hands, I decide to fire out for $900. Once Dev starts talking to himself and playing with the chips and whatnot, we are guaranteed to have the best hand here. We are definitely not guaranteed to have the best shirt, though, because that award can pretty easily go to Dev in this situation. But anyway, after giving it some thought, Dev decides he's a curious guy. He's going to have to see it. He tosses in one chip, signifying a call. We roll over the 5-deuce suited. That's the best hand. Get rewarded for our patience and waiting for the 5-deuce suited to get involved. Hand number 31, we see a raise from Boots on the button, and it's taken us 31 hands to find our first premium holding of the session. Pocket Queens in the small blind, of course. We're putting in the 3-bet here. Go ahead, bump this up. Make it $350 to go. Over to my neighbor now, Scuba Steve in the big blind. He's putting in the cold call, no problem. Back over to Boots on the button, and he makes the call as well. So, heading three ways to a flop with our ladies. Falcons 10-6-5 with two spades. All things considered, pretty good. No overcards. Let's go ahead and c-bet this one. Fire out for $425. Over to Scuba. He likes the price. He makes the call. Boots hates the price. He's out of there. So, we lose one customer. We go heads up to a turn card. The seven of diamonds. So, this board is getting quite connected, and two flush draws now on board. Could definitely make a case for checking here. Lots of two pairs, straights available, all sorts of things. Maybe if we're really deep, I think I might like that option a little bit more. I think with these stacks, I'm just going to bet it. Charge draws, charge pairs, pairs plus draws. I fire out for $750. And once again, Scuba makes the call. So looking for some sort of a clean river card. And that river card is the 10 of hearts. So it pairs the top card on the board. And of course, Scuba could be calling us down here with top pair. Lots of other holdings that would have bricked off here. So I think a check is reasonable here. We could put out a blocker type bet. Not sure if I want to bet call in this spot. But I think when I check, I'm definitely looking to check call here after all those draws miss out. If he's got himself a 10 and he fires out, we're just gonna have to pay him off. But as it turns out, Scuba decides, after thinking about it, to check it back. I tell him I was in the calling mood, probably up to the full amount. He thinks better of it and checks it down with his ace six of clubs. The ladies hold up in this scenario, and we are in the green for the session so far, currently up just a hair under $2,000. Shoot ahead to hand number 45 on the stream, and we are once again all the way down to heads up in another round of the knit game. Myself and Flo, the only two with knit buttons still in front of them. As you can tell, my card debtedness has not improved too much here. Flo coming in for the raise off the button spot. We look down at the 9-8 offsuit. Got to try and get involved here, trying to get rid of this knit button. I make the call out of the big blind, and we have a new competitor sitting on my direct left, Fred Flintstone. He's played in a bunch of streams before. Quite the character. He makes the call as well. So three ways to a flop. Jack 7-6 with two hearts gives us an open ender here. I check it. Fred checks it. Flo, as the initial raiser, decides to check this one back. And we see a brick on the turn, so I think our hand is pretty straightforward here. Gonna have to fire out with our open ender. We just got the 9 high, trying to get this one through. And if we get called, try and improve. Fire out for $600 here on the turn. Fred Flintstone gets out of the way. He didn't have anything going on here. And good news is that neither does Mr. Flo Scoop. He's gonna have to fold his hand. And once again, we make it out by the skin of our teeth, out of the knit game. Don't have to pay the bounty, and we get to drag this pot in with just 9 high. Hand number 48 here, and if you look quickly, don't blink, but Mixon is away from the table and gets dealt pocket aces. That is interesting. Obviously, that's a pretty rare occurrence, but if you play enough of these live streams, you're going to be walking away from the table sometimes, and you're going to get dealt in. It's only a matter of time before you miss some absolute premium hands. Happens to happen to Mixon here. That changes the entire course of this hand. Boots puts on the $100 straddle, and I'm coming in for the raise up to $300 out of the cutoff with the 10-8 of diamonds. Scuba makes the call out of the small blind. Boots defends that straddle out of the hijack spot, and we go three ways to a pretty favorable looking flop here. 9-8-3 with two diamonds, pair plus flush draw. Action checks over to me. Let's fire away at this thing. We do have some showdown value, but we got a lot going on here. We can take the heat in the form of a check raise. Betting for value against these guys, I fire out for $400. Scuba makes the call. Boots is out of there. Down to two players. Heads up to a turn card, which is a total brick. Offsuit deuce. Scuba checks it over to me again. And once again, we have a little bit of a decision between taking our showdown value or firing away here for value. Could go either way. I think in this kind of a spot, I like to go for some value. Let's fire out again. Count out $900 in chips. Make that wager. And Scuba wastes 0 seconds in making the call once again. The two of us heading to a river card, which pretty much bricks out once again, offsuit four. At this point, I think there's a little to a lot less value to be gotten from worse pairs. I announce my pair of eights, show that one down, and that turns out to be the best hand versus Scuba's queen seven of diamonds. So that flop looking a little bit less nice now that we see what we were up against in this spot. Fade the disaster. Thankfully, no diamonds come on turn or river. And thankfully, Mixon happened to be away from the table with those pocket aces that he got dealt. Pocket aces would have held up in this spot. Variance comes in a lot of different forms, I guess. Jumping way ahead now to hand 62 on the stream, because as mentioned, we've been super card dead in the early going through the middle stages of this show into this hand where Blow Scoop comes in for the raise up to $250. I don't even know how much the straddle is in this hand, but 250 out of the hijack, Boots makes the call on the cutoff, and we look down at a nice looking hand. Finally, ace king off suit on the button following a raise and a call. Time to put in the three bet. I decide on a sizing of $1,000 even. Could even go a little bit bigger here because, as you can see, those knit buttons are out in front of players. Playing the knit game once again, don't get the credits that you might usually when the knit game is on. So I think going bigger is a generally good idea, but not terrible, of course, $1,000 to go. Scuba thinks things over, and he doesn't like to miss too many flops, as mentioned. Cold call out of the big blinds, back around to flow in the hijack, and he would like to participate. He makes the call, and Boots going nowhere. Closing the action, makes the call as well. So four ways to a flop, hoping for some improvement, and we see an ace-high flop here, which is great, but three spades on the board, we don't have any of those. Versus three opponents, decent chance there's some spades out there. That being said, when action checks over to me, I think a c-bet is in order here. Don't want to go too big with those three spades out there. Not sure how much equity we retain at this point, but I decide 1300 makes sense. Let's chuck it out there and see what happens. We end up shedding two of our three opponents here. Scuba and Flo get out of the way, but Boots makes the call. So heads up to a turn card, which comes an offsuit four. That one looks pretty damn safe to me. Boots checks it over to me again. Don't think we want to check this one, give any free cards to any single spades out there. It's definitely not comfortable. If we fire out a bet and he rips it all in, not too sure what we're going to have to do in that kind of a spot. But let's cross that bridge if and when we come to it. Decide to fire out for $2,200 here. Boots thinks about it for a little while before making the call. So pot is growing. Pot is now five figures large. And we go heads up to a river card, which is an offsuit queen. Boots thinks about it for a little bit. Checks it over to me again. Is there value to be gotten here? Three streets worth of value in a three bet pot that was four ways on the flop. Can we get value from a worse ace? I'm not too sure if a single pair of aces will call down. This pot feels like it's reasonably big enough, I feel like, for a one pair holding. I'm just going to check this one back, take it to showdown, see what's going on here. And as we can see, Boots has himself ace jack with the jack of spades. So we barely have him pipped here with that queen out there. Good thing that was a queen and not a jack. And good thing no more spades. We get to drag in a small five-figure pot. Hand number 71, and we've got a very casual $800 straddle out there. Yours truly sitting on the $400 straddle. Flintstone putting on the $800 straddle on the button. Scuba, first to act in the small blind, comes in for the $800 limp. Again, this is a 5-10 game, guys. Anyway, an $800 limp. Over to Boots in the hijack, trying to count up all these blinds and all this money. Also comes in for the $800 limp in the hijack. And we look down at a monstrous hand in this game, in this kind of a position. Pocket tens in the cutoff. We will not be coming in for the $800 limp. We're going to be coming in for a raise. Getting after it, all that dead money out there. Let's grab some yellow chips. House four of them. Drop those over the betting line. Raise it up to $4,000. Flintstone in the $800 straddle, thinking things over. Maybe thinks I'm putting in the squeeze, but he's just got himself the 10-7, and he eventually gets out of the way. Back over to Scuba. Does this man like to miss flops? No, he does not like to miss flops. He's going to make the call for $4,000, which is not too far off from half of his stack. Makes the call for $4,000. Boots gets out of the way. So we are going heads up to a flop with this maniac who calls himself Scuba Steve, with almost $10,000 in the middle between these raises and the straddles and limps, etc. Heads up to a flop that comes down ace 5-4 with two diamonds. Not a terrible flop for the pre-flop raiser, but for pocket tens, definitely not the flop of dreams. I don't think we want to just check and give free cards, though. Don't want to see any kings or queens or jacks roll off of this deck. Gonna go ahead and fire down bet significantly, fire out for $2,800, which won't leave too much money behind if Scuba Steve decides to continue, and continue he does. He just goes ahead and rips his stack in there. Do we love this spot? Of course not.
Not what we wanted to see happen here, but it really is not that much more to call. It's only about $3,200 more to make this call, and there's already $18,000 in the middle. What is Scuba Steve going to be doing with a flush draw? What's he going to be doing with a combo draw? What's he going to be doing with a pair of fives or a pair of fours? Chances are with this stack size, he's going to be jamming it in there as well. So he doesn't need to only have an ace here. Doesn't need to have us beat for this price. We're making the call. Somewhat reluctantly toss in the call. We head to a showdown here. And unfortunately, Scuba Steve shows us the ace nine of hearts. Disaster has struck. And it's an even worse story than these equity percentages are telling, because very bad news is that both of the other 10s were folded pre-flop. One from Fred Flintstone's hand and one from Boots's hand. Only way we're going to find our way out of this situation is if it runs out deuce three to chop, but that's not what's going to happen. Turn is a nine and we're automatically drawing dead here. $18,000 in the middle, and that's not going our way. It's going over to Scuba Steve, unfortunately, for us. The man deserves it. He's giving an unlimited amount of action, but that's pretty painful. These are the waves that we're riding. The good news is that according to this cumulative winnings board, we are still up, still in the green, still up $1,820 according to this graphic, but that one does not feel too good. But yeah, these are the waves that we're riding, my friends. When the $800 straddle is on, Fred Flintstone, somewhere around $8,000 effective in that hand. Tough to navigate precisely with a 10 big blind effective stack size is what it is, and we move on. All right, if at first pocket 10s do not work, try them again. Damn it, I think that's the way the saying goes. Hand number 75, another $400 straddle is on in this hand. We see a limp from the big blind, Mr. Boots in the big blind, and we're in the under the gun spot looking down at pocket 10s once again. And of course, once again, we are going to be raising here, getting after it, raising for value, trying to pick up these straddles and dead money, and happy to get some action here with these pocket 10s in this kind of a game. Go ahead, raise it up, make it $1,800 to go in the under the gun spot. Fred Flintstone quickly out of the way and over to Mr. Scuba, who is in the low jack spot. Quickly grabs some yellow chips, doesn't waste too much time, and puts in a three bet up to $4,060. Action back around to Boots, the limper, thinking things over here, kind of hates the situation for some reason, and eventually decides to fold. And as we can see, he's folding ace king, which is very interesting. And I can't say that I blame him considering the action here. $1,800, $4,060. Probably not gonna have too much fold equity here with this ace king. Decides to get out of the way and let it go. And then it is back over to us with these pocket 10s and not very deep when there's a $400 straddle on. If you consider that $400 the big blind, and you imagine a game where you're buying in for 100 big blinds, typically that would equate to a $40,000 stack size. We've got less than $6,000 left behind in this spot. And we are up against a man who calls himself Scuba Steve and has been feeding himself and myself whiskey out of a 1.75 liter bottle all damn night. So what are we going to do in this spot, my friends? After some thought, after looking at this stack size, I think it's pretty clear we're going to be going with the pocket 10s. Go ahead and stuff it in there. And Scuba Steve says snap call, which is not a great sign, but we ask him if he's got a big pair and he says no. That is a very good sign. And we've got ourselves a flip. Once again, a five-figure pot here, somewhere in the neighborhood of $16,000 up for grabs at the flip of a coin.
Good luck, bud.
No ace, no king. Andrew needs to fade an ace or a king. Does. And they just swapped pots on hand.
That is very much a relief, I'm not gonna lie. Heart rate was very much elevated. Maybe we should consider getting heart rate monitors and putting that on stream when we run these live streams here at the lodge. That would be a fun one to see, and just how high my heart rate got in this one would have been fun to see for sure. But let's just say we're very happy with this result, And that will bring up the cumulative winnings graphic once again. And this time we cross the five-figure mark with a profit just over $10,000 at this point. All right, guys, time for a quick little mini rant. I think that the VPIP statistic is useful and it's helpful, but I don't think it tells the full story. I think there are some additional statistics that could be explored out there that would help tell the full story of how much someone is contributing to a game. For example, how many total dollars straddled did each of the players contribute? How about that one? Your boy here putting on the $800 straddle. We got a 5, 10, 25, 50, 100, 200, 400, 800 game going on in this moment, in this hand. All right, back to the action. And in this hand, action folds all the way around to Flo in the hijack spot, who comes in for the raise up to $2,200. Boots out of the way, and we are looking down, closing the action, looking down at ace 10 offsuit on the button. Definitely playing, of course. Do we want a 3-bet? I think it's reasonable. With action folding around to Flo with the nit game on in the hijack spot. Coming in for the raise there, I think we could do a number of things here. We could rip it in. I don't think 3-bet for a different size feels too good, but ripping it in or flatting both make sense. I decide to flat call here. We go heads up to a flop that comes down ace, jack, five, giving us top pair, reasonable kicker. Losing to the strongest of aces, losing to pocket jacks, pocket fives. But all things considered, definitely a pretty good flop here. Flo does rep it, continues for a sizable continuation bet here. $3,500, no down bet from this man. I think we've got a very straightforward call on our hands. As mentioned, losing to some hands, beating a lot of other ones. Let's go ahead and toss in the casual $3,500 bet. Off to turn card, which looks pretty fantastic to me. It's an offsuit 10, which improves us to aces and tens and improves us to a best hand situation versus the times when Flo's got himself ace, king, and ace, queen. We are losing to king, queen now. We're still losing to ace, jack, and pocket jacks, and pocket fives. But what can you do in those kinds of scenarios? And what can you do when Flo puts out a second barrel, fires out for $6,000 this time? And once again, we are not super deep when there's these monstrous straddles on in this game. We're very deep in a 5-10, but this is very far removed from a 5-10 game. At this point, I think our hand is forced. Don't want to call. Doesn't leave hardly anything left on the river. Let's go ahead and jam the rest of the stack in there. Over the $6,000 bet, we announce all in. Flo doesn't wait too long before making the call here. And we show it down, and it's a very surprising situation because Flo had himself ace five for a flopped two pair, but we managed to get there on the turn and turn a better two pair in a massive pot here. Once all the money gets in the middle, we've got over $30,000 in the middle. Fading disaster, at least so far, turning the better hand versus a flopped two pair. Very shocked to see his holding, and I say we can run it twice if he wants to, and he agrees. So we're off to see two river cards, trying to dodge some fives, and there's some chops available as well. Those won't be too disastrous, but if we can hold here, this one is a monster pot.
First one goes to Andrew Neeme. And he will get rid of his nit button. And he will scoop it.
Scooper. Pooper scooper.
Nice hand. Vlog father.
The vlog father wins a $32,000 pot.
97.25.
Andrew starting to heat up. This orbit, in seven hands, Andrew's been involved. He lost an $18,000 pot. He won a $16,000 pot and won a $32,000 pot. Not a bad orbit. The vlog father.
Skiddly-doo, skippity-doo.
A very favorable turn of events in this hand, putting us in the driver's seat on the turn there and very much in the driver's seat on the cumulative winnings graphic that we'll display here, up $26,500 at this point. That's a thin line. We would have probably had to call down with our holding there, the ace 10 unimproved. We would have lost a huge pot, but as it turns out, it's a sick cooler that goes our way, and things are very much looking up in this insane poker game.
Jumping ahead a few hands now, up to hand number 88. What do you know? There's an insane number of straddles on. 5-10 is what this game is listed as. 5-10. Let's try 5-10, 25, 50, 100, 200, 400, 800 again. Picking up the action here, it looks like Scuba Steve has that $800 button straddle on. Couple of limps from Flo and Boots before action gets to me in the hijack spot. Looking down at a pretty nice looking suited ace jack. Once again, one of those spots with a bunch of limpers, and we've got a decent hand that we want to raise with. We're going to try and punish these limpers. We're grabbing a bunch of those yellow chips, a few blacks to go on top, raising it up here to $4,700. I don't know how many games you guys have played in where the initial raise size is $4,700. Not that many for me, but that's what's going on here. Pump this thing up, $4,700 over to Scuba, who, as mentioned, doesn't like to miss too many flops. Debating deep into the tank with his queen nine offsuit, but that eventually, painfully for him, hits the muck. Back over to Flo, who decides he's seen enough insanity. He's going to go with his hand. He goes ahead, sticks the money in there. He's got a little bit less than the amount that I raised to, so he actually calls all in for a little over $4,200. Boots gets out of the way, and as we can see, we are heads up in a fairly fair fight against the king-queen offsuit of Flo. I tell him we can run it once or twice, totally up to him. He decides, you know what, once for blood this time. Let's run it one time, just another small five-figure amount of money in the middle. Things going well for me at this point. Can we keep it going?
That's the best.
Yeah, I'm good. Yeah, I'm fine. There's the nine.
Told you, because
can't do it. It's going to be two straight guys.
No, I have five.
Andrew needs to fade a king or a queen.
I fucking knew it. God damn it.
Nice hand.
And Andrew with ace high is going to win a $10,500 pot.
I think we are officially running good, you guys. Officially running good. The ace jack gets the pure run out, remains the best hand. We scoop in a $10,000 pot. Things are going well in this Friday night game. All right, getting down to it here. Hand number 97 on the stream. Just a $100 straddle on in this hand. 5, 10, 25, 50, 100. Action folds around to the T1000, the Terminator. He goes ahead, bumps this up to $400 out of the small blind. Mixon makes the call on his direct left. Boots gets out of the way. Over to us in the low jack. We just won a hand prior to this. We've got ourselves the fire truck in front of us, and we've got ourselves ace queen off suit in a game full of maniacs. There's a raise, there's a call. Chilling there in the low jack with ace-queen offsuit. Bunch of money out there. Time for a three-bet squeeze. Let's go ahead, three-bet this thing up to $1,800. It's actually a little bit on the small side, which sounds ridiculous. $1,800 is on the small side. But considering the initial raise is $400, there's a call and we're out of position. Kind of want to see this maybe $2,200, $2,500 with this lineup. $1,800 it is. And what do you know, Fred Flintstone coming in for the quick cold call out of the hijack spot. T1000 makes the call, Mixon the only one to release his cards at this point. So three ways to a flop, which comes down 9-6-6 with two clubs. Not the best flop. There's not going to be a whole lot of sixes that we're going to be three betting with from out of position. Much better flop, I think, for the pre-flop callers. So when T1000, who is first to act, he checks out of the small blinds. I'm just going to check this one three ways. We do have the ace of clubs working for us, but I think three ways on this flop, checking makes a lot of sense. That's what I do. Fred Flintstone thinks about it for a little while before checking back. We head to a turn card, which is the eight of clubs. So we do pick up that nut flush draw. Very connected board of middling cards here. As mentioned, I don't think that I'm going to have those too often as the three better. I think the other guy is much more likely to have those. But as mentioned, ace of clubs working for us. T1000 checks it again. I'm still checking here. I would see bet my flush draws, I think, with just the single ace of clubs. I'm going to check it again and see what happens. And this time, Fred does not check back. This time, he fires out for a wager of $4,200. Back over to T1000, who thinks things over for a while before deciding to step aside here. He lets it go. It gets out of the way.
I don't know if we want to just release yet. As mentioned, we have the ace of clubs, and Fred has shown a propensity to get in the mix in this game. He can have a host of hands that we have beat. Ace queen high could very well be good here, especially after the flop goes check check. Would imagine that he would fire with his flush draws on the flop some percentage of the time. Think he would fire if he happened to flop trips on a wet board. Losing to hands like pocket nines and pocket eights, those would make a lot of sense, but it's pretty hard to flop a full house or turn a full house, is it not? Quads, same story. So I decide to make the call, see what happens here on the river, and we do not improve on the offsuit deuce. That's a total brick. Check it over to Fred one more time. Obviously, we're hoping to get to showdown here, hoping he gives up on some sort of a bluff, but give up, he does not. This time, he grabs some of those bubblegum chips, several of them, drops them over the betting line. No small wager here, $15,300. It's a slight overbet of the pot, but there is still some disbelief and some desire within me to make this call here because we block flushes, he checked back on the flop, and with this sizing, would he really be firing away here with a hand like pocket fives, pocket sevens, something like that he cold called with pre-flop? Did not fire with on the flop, facing some overcards. Think he would have bet flop with a hand like pocket tens, pocket jacks. Got to think 6x and flush draws on the flop, as mentioned, would find a barrel. So he's really polarizing himself here. Pocket nines, pocket eights, and pocket sixes seem like the most likely candidates for Mr. Flintstone. Cold calling pre-flop, checking back on the flop, and now firing multiple barrels and big barrels here. You can definitely do this with a bluff, of course. Ace jack, ace 10, king queen, queen jack suited, queen 10 suited, jack 10 suited. Lots of stuff that has basically no showdown value in this spot. Really tempted and really curious here to toss this in because I'm a bit of a non-believer and I feel like there's a lot more bluffs in his range than there are value hands. Full houses and quads, those are tough to make. But in the end, decide not getting a very good price here. Think he can have some stuff. Even Fred Flintstone can get a hand once in a while. So decide, after some thought, to release my ace queen high. And as we can see, Fred does in fact have the value hand. He's got himself the 8-6 of hearts. Not exactly a combo that I had in mind, because he did check back on the flop with trip sixes, trapping. And thank goodness we do not river a club, because that would have been pretty big disaster, making a flush versus the full house. Managed to get away from it here. Do not make the curious call on the end. Thankfully, avoid disaster there.
Guys, we had ourselves a very interesting session in that room where insanity happens. It doesn't really feel like real life in there. There is just insane things that go on inside that room. Massive monetary swings. And we are lucky enough to end up on the good side of things this session. We definitely find some run good towards the second half of that session. I don't feel like I had that good of card distribution. It would be an interesting experiment to go through and mark down every single hand that I was dealt in this session and to just see what those cards look like. I have a feeling for the majority of that session, they're gonna be very trashy hands. Try and give action where you can, you know? As, you know, one of the hosts of all things that happen around here, trying to keep that VPIP up where I can, making some very suspect calls pre-flop and just hoping things work out okay in the end. And in this session, they do. We get into this game for $6,000, cash out of this game for $30,625. That's a profit of $24,625. The flip goes our way. We find some favorable situations that go our way, clearly. And, you know, feeling pretty happy and pretty grateful about it because these kinds of swings, they mean something to me. I had 100% of my action today, and to come out with a basically $25,000 win, 100% of the action, is significant for me. So I'm thankful and grateful for it, let's put it that way. Happy to be a part of all things Lotch and to have this opportunity and to be a part of the team here. Anyway, appreciate you guys tuning in. Very thankful for that as well. It's been like an interesting last few months and this is a good day. So happy about that. Thanks for watching. Would love it if you would subscribe. And if you want to see more of this sort of thing, click that subscribe button. appreciate it a lot. See you guys soon. Cheers.